Welcome to the Zelda Informer podcast. I am your host, Alfred Tabex, on this fine Monday night at 8:03 p.m., which is when we are recording this. Tonight, I am joined by two fantastic men. First is our own Colin. Say hi, Colin. He has a kazoo, in case you couldn't tell. And then we are also joined today by a very special guest, my friend Ty. Say hi.
Hi.
So, we don't have a lot of news. Well, we got some news this week, but nothing too big. But we're going to go through it all and then have another thing at the very end planned. Try to do that every week now. just have something different planned. Next week's going to be a little bit more interesting. But first and foremost, let's get to the news. So, a recent report came out a few days ago, about a day ago or today, saying that Tantalus, the company that worked behind Twilight Princess HD, is developing games for the Nintendo Switch. The CEO of the company said, "I can confirm that we're working on Switch and have been for some time. Our titles haven't been announced as of yet, but keep an eye out for more news soon. We've always worked with Nintendo platforms, and now, of course, after Twilight Princess HD, our relationship with Nintendo is stronger than ever. I expect fans will look back through Nintendo's catalog and think about titles which they'd like us to bring to the Switch, and everyone should feel free to make suggestions on our Facebook page." So I'm going to toss that question to you guys. What do you think that they'd be working on? Like, what do you hope they're working on? And just have a ball with that one.
I'm quickly looking up, like, games they have made that aren't Twilight Princess HD, so I have a really good idea of what they've worked on in the past. Wow, not much. I mean, there's like a shitload of licensed stuff, like just like console ports of just games. I don't know. They have House of the Dead on here. Ask Sega to bring House of the Dead to Nintendo Switch.
Like a remake or just like a new game?
All of them. All four of them.
I wouldn't.
And the one that I... for Overkill. There we go. In terms of Nintendo franchises, I think we can all agree that Urban Champion needs a HD remaster. Urban Champion is the greatest game of all time. If you own a 3DS and you don't own the 3D Classics version of Urban Champion, you, my friend, are bad at video games. It's just, you're not good.
So you want an Urban Champion HD port to the Switch?
Yes.
Okay, well, you could drop that on their Facebook page. Just let them know.
Hell yeah.
What about you, Ty? What are you looking forward to, or what do you hope?
I think, based on their work with Twilight Princess, I wouldn't be surprised at all if they weren't possibly working on a Skyward Sword HD. Especially with,
You hear that? It's Urban Champion!
Oh,
fucking
boy, Colin.
Bring it to the Switch! Also, yeah, I was gonna make a joke about Skyward Sword HD, but
yeah, well, I mean, especially with
Funnier.
I think it was Aonuma. A while back, he was asked about, you know, Twilight Princess HD, or not Twilight, the possibility of Skyward Sword HD, and he said it, you know, it's a possibility, or you know, it could definitely happen or something. So, I don't know. That just seems like something that might happen in terms of non-Zelda games. For whatever reason, I feel like Super Mario Sunshine might be a game that they might want to make an HD remake for. I don't know what makes it, just for some reason I feel like that particular game is, you know, one that's prime for an HD remake above, you know, some others. I don't know. It's really tough to say, though. There's so many things they could do. You know, basically their entire catalog, Wii and you know, prior.
Yeah. I mean, I could see a Super Mario Sunshine HD remake. I think that'd be cool. We get new graphics and updated graphics for it.
Oh, man, we get to see the opening cutscene that's like 10 minutes long where Mario says full sentences and in full glorious HD, and it's still going to be really uncomfortable.
I feel like we've had this conversation before, Colin.
Did we have that on the previous podcast?
The last one you were on, I think we talked about that, too.
We can't. There's no way to talk about Sunshine without me going on about how it's
about that game. Is that
It's so fucking weird that Mario says full sentences.
I'm sorry.
I don't like it.
I'm sorry it makes you uncomfortable. But I think that'd be a great game to come to HD. You know, we'd get new paint textures and stuff, and that game was already beautiful on the GameCube. Doesn't really hold up on a big screen TV, though. Everything's really pixelated.
Well, that's because you don't have the fucking $200 GameCube component cables like I do.
So unless you're Colin, then it doesn't look as good. Let me see.
Or you could just get the component cables for the Wii. It's the same goddamn thing.
What do I play it on? No, I just played it on the GameCube. I don't have a Wii anymore. Let's see. I don't know. I'm probably one of the few people that still holds on to hope that more of these games are coming, but I'd like to see, like, Gale of Darkness or Pokemon Coliseum get an HD port to the Switch. With, like, you know, as much as I'd like to see that, I'd also like to see continuations on those with all the Pokemon, but those are great games.
I mean, if I'm gonna be complete, like, actually serious, Urban Champion, no, but actually, I don't know. I feel like I would love to see... I was thinking about this the other day, and I would love to see a collection of remakes of some of Nintendo's older kind of arcadey games for the NES. None of, like, the really, like, big-name stuff, like Mario Brothers, but, like, baseball and pinball and golf and stuff like that.
So, like, just actual 3D modeled remakes of those, or just, like...
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, not just sports games, but, you know, stuff like Radar Scope and stuff like that. I feel like that'd be really cool. It seems like Nintendo really wants to kind of bring back this air of nostalgia to, like, oh, remember when Nintendo did a port of Joust for the NES? Like, stuff like that I think would be really cool to see kind of brought back. I mean, they keep bringing back the goddamn Game & Watch. They might as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to tell with Nintendo because everything's on the table for them, it seems, like, in terms of remaking games. Though, I wouldn't be shocked if we got Ocarina of Time HD remake for the Switch. Like, that's almost the next inevitable step that we're gonna see.
Would we, or do you think they're just gonna stick to their guns of having the 3DS ports do that?
I don't know, because I think that the
Majora's Mask was on 3DS and not Wii U was kind of telling of that.
Well, but it also ran with kind of the same engine. So, like, they just kind of ported it over and took those assets over. But, I don't know, I feel like Ocarina of Time's too big of a game for them to just kind of leave on the handheld. And for them to, like, oh, well, we're going to rebuild it with HD textures and, you know, put it on the Nintendo Switch, you know, updated with all these different things. I mean, I could see that happening at some point. I don't know if that's the game they're working on. If it was up to me, I'd get an HD remix or HD remaster to Luigi's Mansion, but that's probably never going to happen.
That'd be nice.
Mm-hmm. I mean, really, unfortunately, as of right now, we can only really talk about HD remakes, because that's really all that this company has done.
Yeah.
But, like... I mean, if we want to talk about games that I would love to actually see come to the Switch as in new installments of franchises, ooh boy. But, actually, if we're going to talk about GameCube Remix, fuck it. Eternal Darkness HD. Let's do it.
Does Nintendo still have the rights to that? Or, who had the rights to that?
They might?
I thought I saw some kind of article a while back. This might be a few years back now about them, like, renewing the trademark, or maybe that was them not renewing it.
I think they did, just for whatever reason.
Yeah, but they like to do that with their trademarks, regardless of whether they're using it or not, so that could mean anything.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot, we're probably going to see another Resident Evil game on the Switch, probably another remastered. I mean, they're just shoveling those things out now. I mean, pretty much anything that you could think of that's already kind of being developed might get an HD remake. And this is kind of like in the same vein, but not really. Do you guys think that we're going to see then Final Fantasy VII on the Switch?
Yeah, maybe.
I
think it really comes down to if whether or not the Switch sells. It's really hard to pinpoint if games that are coming out in 2017 are going to be released on the Switch, or whether or not developers are going to wait first.
Yeah.
And then port later. Because, I mean, right now, we still don't know. I mean, we still don't know. Aside from Breath of the Wild and, like, one random... Okay. Aside from Breath of the Wild, two Dragon Quest games, a Just Dance game, Sonic Generations 2 and some Oculus Rift game that no one gives a shit about.
We know Mario's coming too, like a new Mario game.
But here's the thing, well, Nintendo even said, was like, well, what you just saw wasn't confirmed.
I think they say
also
that more...
Pikmin 4. There's no way Pikmin 4 isn't coming to the Switch at this point.
When it comes to Nintendo, but, not, you know, they said, you know, and the third parties that have also shown games on that, like, Bethesda was, Skyrim, you know, they said that there's no official game announcements just because I think they're not ready to officially formally announce these games, but I think we can
safely assume
that these are actually coming.
I mean, I don't doubt for a second that, like, that Mario game is real.
Yeah.
I'm just putting out the precedent that it hasn't been actually announced yet, but sure. They wouldn't focus on it so much if it wasn't real.
Do you think that all those companies would, like, Ty said, would port Skyrim over, or, you know, what have you, over to the NX, or Switch, sorry, in hopes of, like, expanding their audience then? Because there are people that only have Nintendo consoles and they don't buy PlayStation, they don't buy Xbox. Do you think they'd see that as a worthwhile venture then?
Maybe. I mean, that would bring a pretty good point, you know, that company, because all they've really done in the last couple of years have been doing, as I said, ports and HD remakes, so maybe they're actually focused on porting third-party titles over to the Switch and helping out, yeah. But I don't know. In terms of whether or not third-party ports and remakes would allow people to come over, I think so. I think they just have to be timed decently.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I don't see Activision releasing, like, Infinite Warfare on the Switch. But whatever game, whatever Call of Duty game comes next,
yes,
they might.
Yeah.
They just have to actually, like, include support for things like DLC.
Well, I mean, they've always done that, but like you said, they never really keep the support going for it. Like, Black Ops 2 came out for the
Black
Wii
Ops 2
U.
had one map, Ghosts had one map.
Yeah.
Was it.
Like, it was more along the lines of, like, an obligatory, hey, this thing's out, and we might as well just get the game out onto these consoles. But I think that we might see, with the NX, more the Switch, more partnerships with third-party companies being like, okay, well, this isn't just another obligatory console that we need to make a crappy PS2 port for. Like, this is something that we can actually make games for and actually, like, tailor our games to, like, tailor ports to. That being said,
I sure hope so.
I mean, I think it'd be great. I mean, like, so far that's what we're hearing.
I want Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege 2 on the Switch. I want to be able to sit on a plane and play online with my fellow dads over the internet and scream "It's a siege" while, like, blowing up walls. And everyone looks at me like a madman.
Your battery life's gonna die really fast.
I'll plug it into the thing, the little outlet. I don't care.
See, I think the portability of Switch is probably going to be, like, I feel that's the bigger draw than just getting, you know, the Nintendo audience, because the Nintendo audience seems to largely ignore third parties for the most part. But I think there's going to be a whole new audience with Switch that want to see these, you know, these console games on the go with Switch, and I feel like that's why we're seeing such a strong presence of third-party support at that beginning.
If rumors are to be believed, apparently, according to a newspaper report, apparently when you have the tablet in the docking station, it's going to get 1.5 terabytes of power, which is more than a PS4.
Yeah.
But then once you take it off the docking station and you're using it on the go, it's going to be like 3/4 of a teraflop, which is like slightly less than the Xbox One, but then you have to consider the fact that the screen is 720p.
Yeah,
so exactly. that wouldn't be, so killing the resolution wouldn't be that big of a deal. And that makes sense, considering you wouldn't want a teraflop and a half capable handheld, or else you're... I mean, anyone who's ever owned a gaming laptop will tell you the thing will just die.
Yep. Instantly.
Within the hour, yeah.
So, we kind of got off topic there, but that's okay, because that's what we do. But on to the next one.
We have no topics.
We have no topics.
That's why.
This is anarchy. Yeah. There's anarchy when I'm in charge. So, this... yep, there's your kazoo. I was waiting for that. So, November 2nd, Nintendo rolled out the update, the huge update for Animal Crossing New Leaf. Included with that were 50 plus amiibo cards and figurines that you could add that they're shoveling out. And then you could also add, this is kind of where it ties in, so I'm not just throwing this out there. You can add Splatoon characters and clothes using the Marie and the other one, I forgot the name, Callie. There you go.
Oh my god.
Those two amiibos, you can get characters in Animal Crossing moving in your town that resemble them. Or you could use Legend of Zelda amiibos and get Medley, Ganondorf, Epona, or Wolf Link into your town. and you can also get items from them and get different things from them. They also rolled out a bunch of other features. It actually got me to play the game again, which I haven't played in apparently a year, according to all my villagers. But yeah, I got back into it. And it's keeping me going for now. They've also added, in case you guys are wondering, daily challenges where you can go throughout the day and, you know, sell X amount of apples, catch this bug, sell whatever it is. But they'll have daily challenges that keep you coming back, which is kind of nice. So, what are your guys' thoughts on this new update? Will it keep?
I'm sure my sister is ecstatic.
Have you not played Animal Crossing in a while, Colin?
She has my cartridge. I can't play it. But I mean, I guess it's fine, because these changes sound cool, and I guess she'll enjoy the game more.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm loving the update. I haven't played in probably over a year. It's bad. My town, like, most of my... I still haven't cleaned up my town from how just there's... I don't even know what I was doing last time I played. There was items all over the, ground. My house is a mess. I don't know. So, but the new features are great. I'm loving the amiibo. You know, I have Wolf Link in my town now. It's awesome. It's really gotten me to play too. The whole community, the Animal Crossing community, seems to be, you know, coming alive again, which is really nice to see.
Yeah, like my fiance hadn't played in a while, and she got back into it because of the update. So, it's done its job.
What are the sales of Animal Crossing New Leaf? It really makes me wonder, like, how well that game has sold for them to continuously update it.
Yeah, they've been giving updates for bigger and
better things. Yeah.
Like, they haven't...
It's been, like, a couple of years now.
Yeah. Let me look that up real quick.
Because the game came out, like, what, a year before Mario Kart 8, and it's still getting DLC?
Still getting
like, a year after Mario Kart 8 got DLC, stopped getting DLC?
It sold a total of 9.7 million units worldwide.
Honestly, I was kind of expecting a little more, but still, holy shit.
Yeah, that's a lot. And that, you know, it's still, when it came out, whenever it came out.
That is, like, roughly a sixth of what the 3DS has sold, isn't it?
Yeah. That came out November 8th. No, June 9th in America. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then...
What year?
2013.
Yeah, exactly.
And then November 8th in Japan, 2012, and Europe got it, like, a few days later than us. And so, like, that's still a big number from,
yeah, that is...
from all those dates.
Huh.
And they've kept it going. Like, there's... They'd still send out updates like, hey, you've got this thing from Nintendo whenever you logged into the game. So obviously they think it's a worthwhile venture, and they thought it was more worthwhile to go ahead and add completely new sections to the game and things that are completely new, which, you know, was great. You know, I feel like not that I have a brand new game, but it extended the life for Animal Crossing New Leaf for me, for however long that's going to be, which is pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, another part of their plan is that they've got the, December 2nd, I believe, along with the new amiibo, they're releasing a new version of the game that includes the update and everything. Mm-hmm. Animal Crossing New Leaf Welcome Amiibo. So they're probably expecting to get a lot of new players in with that, and it's probably I think they're probably expecting it to be one of their big amiibo titles too to push, because they've got, you know, all those Animal Crossing amiibo that are sitting there, unfortunately not selling very well. So maybe New Leaf will change that. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, this kind of goes into our next topic, too, is, as Colin pointed out earlier before the podcast started, is that Nintendo is releasing on November 25th two limited edition versions of the new Nintendo 3DS, not the XL version, just the standard version.
Yeah, the good one.
For $100, which is just a little bit more expensive than the 2DS, which is already $80. and which is all what the 2DS misses, you know, obvious things like glasses free 3D. And this handheld is half the price of the new 3DS XL. And they have, these new ones have like Mario Mushroom Kingdom prints on the back. But kind of like Ty was saying, like, you know, you think maybe they're releasing these close to each other thinking, well, we've got these new 3DSs out, and now we'll have like a quote unquote new Animal Crossing game to bring out. And Colin, you said you were planning on getting one of these.
Oh, absolutely. I gotta say, I owned the original 3DS at launch, and it was an uncomfortable meh. It's not very comfy. And then I got the XL, and it's so comfy. And then I got the new 3DS XL, and it's pretty damn comfy. And then I tried out the new 3DS at Nintendo New York, and I was like, wow, this is what the original should have been.
Yep.
And it's not the size of, like, three Samsung Note 7s, like, taped together. So, there you go. So, yeah, no, I'm excited to get one if they don't sell out by the time I'm able to head to Best Buy.
I think they're going to be popular. I know I have a number of friends who have been waiting, holding out, and not updating their, you know, upgrading their 3DS because they wanted specifically the smaller new 3DS in black. My roommate refused to update because he wants the black one, not a white one. So there's a lot of people out there who they're probably going to be, you know, rushing to get this.
Yep. I feel bad for my sister because she just went out and bought a 2DS a few days ago, or about a month ago. So, she's missing out. But moving on then.
And they're cheap enough that I can just trade in my old 3DS XL and probably make all of it back.
Yep.
Because I think those things go for like, what, 80? So.
And then some, yeah.
Yeah.
So moving on. There's been a rumor that's been going around past few days, I guess. It was really popular today. Saw it everywhere. Was that somehow someone got the idea, and this has been going on for a while as well, that Kingdom Hearts 3 is being released on the Switch.
Oh my fucking god, really?
Colin's dying.
I am. But I've been sick all weekend.
So the rumor is that it's coming to the Nintendo Switch, and, you know, it's part half unbelievable because I don't think we're ever going to get Kingdom Hearts 3. But the rumor is that it's coming to Nintendo Switch, and that they've already, Square Enix has pledged support, which, you know, they have on the whole graph that Nintendo made, or the graphic or whatever. But this kind of goes along with what we were saying earlier in terms of them wanting to bring in a new audience. But here's the thing, is that no other Kingdom Hearts games have come, well, that's not true, no core mainline normally numbered Kingdom Hearts games have come to a Nintendo console.
See, people have said that, and yet they're also releasing Kingdom Hearts 3 on the Xbox One.
I know, which is weird. That's what I was thinking.
Though, at the same time, apparently that version was canceled, but maybe only in Japan? Who knows anymore?
No idea.
Who actually knows anymore?
Yeah. Who knows with Square Enix in general?
Yeah, Square Enix is really... They're I don't know, but they... it wouldn't surprise me, though, because with Square Enix's... they were pretty close to Nintendo recently. And the Kingdom Hearts series, while, like you said, no mainline numbered games, there have been a lot of Kingdom Hearts games on Nintendo handhelds, mm-hmm. and again, Switch with the console and handheld portion. Like, I don't know, it just seems like it's not crazy. I think it could happen.
Yeah, I mean, I don't see any reason to not think that it won't come. There's no reason to think that it won't come to the Switch. But we'll see. Like, again, we don't 100% know the specs on the power of the Switch. We can only postulate and take guesses.
All we know is that it runs Unreal Engine 4, and that Kingdom Hearts 3 runs on Unreal Engine 4. So that's really about it.
So it may come, it may not. We're not going to make any promises because we don't know. Obviously, we're guessing.
It might. I mean, Square Enix is like desperate for a hit right now.
Yeah.
You can really tell by the way they're going like really all out on Final Fantasy 15. So
maybe. That'd be an interesting game to see on the Switch.
Yeah, maybe.
But
if it's good.
Yeah. Well, it's been delayed several times, so it better be good.
Yeah, but then they released the Platinum demo, and it was awful compared to the Duske demo.
Yeah.
Oh, lordy.
But, yeah, that's all we have for news topics. Like I said, really not a lot happened. Just rumors and guessing of things. And somebody asked, we have like one guest question on Facebook, and one of them was in Spanish. And I didn't really understand it.
Translate it using Bing.
I did, and it was... The person asked, why can't you finish... Basically, why can't you play the game, or why doesn't the game save after you beat Ganon in Zelda games? And I don't know.
Because video games don't do that.
Well, like, it's... Because Zelda is a game that has a beginning, middle, and end. There's really nothing, like... Like, you do everything before the final battle with Ganon, yeah, and then that's supposed to be the end of the game. So that's a similar
answer. Video games question. Usually don't save at the end of the game.
Unless it's like an open world game like Borderlands or something where,
yeah,
you know, you beat the final boss and it's like, oh, well, there's an after story or an epilogue or whatever. and then we got another question. This is another simple one. Brandon Murphy said, possible times at Breath of the Wild could be shown off again. I think that the next time we're going to see that game is at the Switch reveal in January.
Yeah, there you go. You answered your own question there, pal.
Yep. I think that that's where that's going to come up.
Urban Champion 4K, January 5th, Nintendo Switch reveal. Calling it now. Suck on that one, Emily Rogers. You don't got shit on me. I got high quality, top tier rumors.
I thought you were just going to say you were high. I was like, I wouldn't doubt it. Yep, there you go.
We could see some footage possibly at the Game Awards in December.
True. Oh, yeah, that's a thing.
That's when we saw the first, you know, we had that gameplay demo a while back. Mm-hmm. Was that last year or was that the year before?
It's been so long. 3 years ago.
I mean, at the rate Nintendo has been dropping gameplay footage, it could come out whenever. Because, I mean, it seems like every other week they're like, oh, new gameplay trailer for Breath of the Wild shows Link walking in place.
Yeah, it's like the same footage of, like, different footage of the same thing so far.
Can I just like, say something about Breath of the Wild real quick? I didn't mention this, like, when the Switch was announced, and it bothers me, so I'm gonna do it. Okay, there was one thing I did not like about the Breath of the Wild gameplay in the Switch reveal trailer. And that is, I don't know if anyone else is going to know what I'm talking about, but the music sounded like one of those Windows XP remixes that you'd find on YouTube back in the day, where they would make songs using, like, the Windows sounds.
You mean for the Switch trailer in general, or just the Breath of the Wild?
The Breath of the Wild section of the Switch trailer.
I have no idea. I didn't catch that.
At the beginning of the trailer, before it starts playing, ha 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 ha, yeah, they have some Breath of the Wild footage with music, presumably from Breath of the Wild, and it sounds like every Windows error sound effect, like, and click, like, put together in a weird remix. I swear to God, listen to it again. You're going to be able to unhear it, or you won't be able to unhear it. Hell, I'm just going to... Here, we're going to... Right now, real, live, 2016, you guys can listen to it. It's in, like, the first 10 seconds.
Go for it.
Do it, right there. No, fucking, I'm not gonna play it over my speaker.
Oh, well, I'll just put it in the video.
Yeah.
Like, right where my face is. We'll play it. I'll pause everything else. So yeah, that's Colin's tangent that I've inserted. Into
maybe even put in a clip of one of those Windows XP remixes, so you know what I'm talking just about.
If it sounds like it, we'll do the side.
I told this to Bryhard. He used to work at Zelda Informer, and he said, "Fuck you, Colin." So, I guess I'm right.
Okay, so we don't have any more fan topics or news topics, but I do have something that I want us to talk about, and Colin, I want us to carefully and calmly debate about these topics.
Oh.
So carefully and calmly. So, I just want to go around and talk about our favorite game and our least favorite game.
Oh. Ooh.
Oh, jeez.
Mamma mia, that's a spicy Dios mio.
So, your favorite game and then your least favorite. It doesn't have to be on a Nintendo console. It could be on any...
Urban Champion. No. Favorite game is going to have to be Doom.
the just, original or the
yeah
new
the
one?
Original the original Doom. I think in terms of the phrase the Citizen Kane of gaming is passed around a lot, just willy nilly. And as much as I hate that term, and as much as everyone hates that term, I get what people mean when they say it, because Citizen Kane was a game. Citizen Kane was a movie. It was a movie film that I own on Laserdisc that changed the course of how movies were made in terms of direction, in terms of style, in terms of cinematography. It paved the way for pretty much all modern cinema that we have now. And I think when it comes to video games, there's only two I can think of that actually carry that, because no one called Citizen Kane like the Citizen Kane of movies until like 40 years after that happened. So we can't just like go like, oh yeah, Titanfall 2 is a Citizen Kane, because it's brand new. We don't know what effect it's going to have on the industry until years from now. But I've always thought that if there is a Citizen Kane of gaming, it would have had to have happened in the early 90s, right around the introduction of 3D. And I think the two games that really, really cover that are Doom and Super Mario 64. But I think Doom just edges it out for being 3 years younger. In terms of gameplay, in terms of level design, in terms of just overall just mechanics, Doom has not aged a day since December 10th, 1993. No matter what platform you play it on, even if you play it on the latest, like, gaming rig, or if you play it on the 386 DOS machine, or even, like, the fucking SNES port, it is still perfectly manageable from front to back, and one of the best experiences you'll ever have.
So what's your least favorite game?
Now that's the tricky one, because I've played a lot of garbage in my day. Because I know what you want me to say.
You can't say No Man's Sky.
I'm not going to say No Man's Sky. I know you want me to say The Last of Us, because you're an edgy teenager.
No, I love The Last of Us.
I know, but that's why you... Because you want me to say things, and then we curse words, and it's going to be funny XD. What is the worst game I've ever played? I mean, I can tell you the worst game I've played in the last 3 weeks.
Sure.
Mafia 3.
Yeah, that's... I thought that was coming up, too.
Mafia 3 is a game that is fundamentally broken. Not just from a... The glitches are gone. They're all gone. At least on the Xbox One version. The game's no longer glitching out. But the game is still broken on a mechanical level. I can't believe they released a game like this in this year, and then they say, oh, to make our money back, we have to sell 8 million copies. Where the hell did the budget go? I really don't know what the worst game of all time is, because or at least what my least favorite game of all time, because I collect video games for a living. Hi, that's what I do. And, I mean, I've played tons of crap. And I mean, there's stuff that I've either like played for a second and then just thrown away because it's garbage, or I could do things that like personally offend me, like 007 Legends. I don't really know, but like that seems to be a harder question for me. As cynical as I am, I'm always harder to find what is the worst thing to me than what is the best thing. But yeah, Mafia 3 right now.
Okay.
Tangent.
What about you, Ty?
Okay, so that's a tough one. So in terms of my personal favorite, not like, you know, best of all time or anything. Personally, I always want to answer the latest Super Smash Bros. Game, but that feels like cheating.
Yeah, wait, I'm sorry to cut you off. I should have fucking said this. I'm also under the belief that what you think is the best game of all time shouldn't also be your favorite game of all time.
Yeah.
Doom, Doom has always been my favorite before I actually thought about how it is as a, like, how it stands as one of the greatest games ever. But, yeah.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, I wasn't sure if you were going with, you know, like, if you were saying that Doom is your favorite or... But yeah, no, that's... I totally get that.
Yeah,
I mean, in terms of what game I just love to play, you know, I'm a big Nintendo guy, you know. I play pretty much everything Nintendo, so... I love Smash Brothers. I love Sakurai's games in general. A Nintendo crossover developed by Sakurai, it's like, oh, it's the best thing ever. So, yeah, I love my Super Smash Brothers. If I'm gonna not count that, though, just because, I don't know, I always feel like that's like a like that cheating. I don't know. it's so tough. Because it really depends based on, you know, are we talking in terms of a multiplayer experience? Are we talking in terms of, like, a great adventure? In terms of, like, just in general, kind of based on, you know, all the aspects like that, I'd probably have to say currently Kid Icarus Uprising. I love Kid Icarus Uprising. Again, another Sakurai game as well.
Behind that.
It's it had great multiplayer on top of a great single player. The dialogue was great. It looked phenomenal on the 3DS. Made great use of the 3D and everything. It did a lot of things so right. I love that game. I know a lot of people. It can be divisive among people. With the controls and all, I personally didn't have a problem, so I love the game. In terms of least favorite, that's jeez, I don't know. When it comes to gaming, I tend to be a very positive person. I don't like to speak negatively about games much, because I figure, like, you know, video games are a form of entertainment. Why am I wasting my time complaining? So I generally don't. I try to find enjoyment from all the games I play. Of course, I enjoy some more than others, as anyone would. So, when it comes to games that I have played, and, like, games that I own and have played, at least some of, you know, more than, like, a minute, I'd probably have to say Sonic Boom Rise of Lyric. I own that game. I'm a Sonic fan, so, you know, I want to play all the Sonic games. I still have not played more than, like, maybe an hour of that game. It's just so... It feels so soulless. Like, I don't know. I couldn't play it. I tried playing through it with a friend, and we had to put it down. It's like, this isn't fun.
Yep. I can feel that
as well. What about you?
So this is hard for me, because I have a lot of favorite games.
Where does the debate, like, part come into this?
So you probably won't disagree with my favorite games, but you're probably gonna disagree with my favorite.
Okay.
So, like, my favorite. This is gonna sound so stereotypical. My favorite game of all time.
Offer enough time.
No. It's a tie between two games, and one is Undertale. I don't think I've ever enjoyed a game that much. I know, I'm sorry. You can groan. And then the other games, like, my other favorite games, they're all on GameCube. So, like the honorable mentions get, like, Kirby's Air Ride.
Ooh, yes.
Great game. Then you got Pikmin 2, which is probably, like, my third favorite game. Wait a minute.
Roll it back. I know what the worst video game I've ever played is. Oh my god, I can't... I don't know how this slips out. Okay, so there is this Flintstones game on the Sega Master System. And it is...
Say no more.
It is... No, I have to talk about this. It is one of the most maddening pieces of just entertainment I've ever played. Just to give you a heads up of the, I'm going to give you the whole game. It's only four levels long, okay? Level one, Fred must paint the wall. It is...
What wall?
There is a wall in the Flintstone household, and basically Fred is like, Wilma, I want to go bowling. And then Wilma's like, okay, but you gotta paint the wall! And so Fred... the whole level is Fred... with a paintbrush, or it's a little dinosaur. It's meant to be a paintbrush, because it's a living. He goes to a paint bucket, and he paints a wall. He even gets up on a ladder, paints the top, moves to the bottom, paints the bottom, refills the paintbrush, moves the ladder. He has to paint the whole fucking wall. During this time, you have an RNG-based Pebbles who will just break out of her crib and draw on the wall, thus fucking up your progress. And you're on a timer! You have to do this within, like, a minute and a half, or else you have to do the whole wall over again. The second level is you gotta drive to the bowling alley. Along the way, Fred will just ram into rocks, thus causing the fucking spokes of his foot car to break off, and he has to go scramble off, pick up the wheels, lift up the car, reattach the wheels, and head on driving. And that's also on a timer. And even worse, if you fucked up the timing in the first level, it fucks up this timing in the second level, and you can actually, like, arrive at the bowling alley and it'll be like, oh, it's closed. Gotta start the game over again. Third level is you have to beat Barney in a bowling game. It sucks. It's just a shitty bowling minigame. And then, somehow, Pebbles get stuck in a sky fortress, so you have to scale up a tall building and save Pebbles from a sky fortress. I don't know what! And you gotta bring her back. And that's it. The whole game is like 10 minutes total, but my god, it will take you hours to beat it. And
maybe I'll just get footage of that.
And the whole time, I can actually give you footage. The whole time, all you hear is the whole time.
Was that whole thing just a setup so you could play the kazoo?
No, it wasn't. Oh my god, if you want to learn more, if you want to learn more about the Flintstones for Master System, there's two really good resources. There's A, the No Death Run of Flintstones for Sega Master System on YouTube, or B, my personal preferred source, Austin Eruption of Arcadia's Top 10 Worst Licensed Game Videos. I make a cameo because I actually own this piece of shit, and I recorded the footage and I sent it in to him, and oh my god. Oh my god. Go on. You can continue now. Oh.
So, I guess my top favorite game is, I always say, it's Luigi's Mansion. I love that game.
It's a good one.
I play it through like every year, like 4 or 5 times, just because I freaking love that game. Didn't like Dark Moon as much. Lacked everything that the original had that made it great. Thank you. And it just, it's my favorite game of all time. It's amazing. Everything about it's amazing. It's perfect. You know, it's great.
That's good. Yeah.
My least favorite game. So obviously, since it's a Zelda former podcast, and I haven't said that No Man's Sky is a disappointment yet, there's my obligatory No Man's Sky is a disappointment. And you're going to have to let me explain myself. So I acknowledge what this game did for gaming and how revolutionary it was to have this big game come out. And it was great for its time. Just, I don't think it held up. I don't think the gameplay held up. Graphics didn't. I mean, my least favorite game is Final Fantasy VII.
Oh.
And I don't think that game is good anymore. Like, it was like, oh, yeah, this came out on 2 discs for the PlayStation, and
it was actually amazing because it's
3 discs. Because it's a huge game, it was revolutionary, it had, like, this open world and this overarching story.
I'm going to ask you something.
Don't find it that fun.
Yeah. I'm not... Don't worry, I'm not a big Final Fantasy person, so you're off the hook. But have you played Final Fantasy VIII?
No, but have you played? Been told that 6 and 8 are better.
Who the fuck told you 8 was better? Who did that? It's so much worse! No! Well, I guess There you go. No, 8 is worse. 7, there's, whatever. There's 7 might be overrated, but 8 is no. 6 is better though.
So I should play 8 and then come back and talk about how much I dislike it.
And you should play 10 too.
10 2 or 10 as well?
No, just 10 2.
Okay, because that's the confusing part about Final Fantasy. 13 as well or 13 number 2?
13 dos.
Okay. All right. Yeah, that's the confusing part. At least it doesn't get like 365 over
2. Oh, and Mystic Quest.
Final Fantasy Builders, Explorers.
Whatever. Shut up! Shut! Also, that's Dragon Quest!
Alright, so I think that's it for the least favorite games. We didn't have as much contention as I thought we would. I just always expect an argument with Colin. I always expect him to say something.
No, you have to say actually bad games.
Yeah, my least favorite game is like something, or my favorite game is something terrible. No. I have good taste.
Listen, I'm used to this. I'm used to this squabble of people being like, oh, I have such a contrarian opinion on video games. Oh, yeah, what's your least favorite game of all time? You know, I didn't care for Ocarina. It's like, wow, get in line.
I feel like you're throwing shots at Nate right now, because that's what he says every time we bring up least favorite Zelda games. Yeah, he's like, I just don't like it. I know everybody else does, but... Because then he says, well, my favorite Zelda game is Zelda 2. Too.
And he's like, my least favorite is
Ocarina of Time. Which is a great game. It's just those are two contrary opinions.
Yeah, no, exactly. I mean, I love Zelda 2. I love me some Zelda 2. Don't get me wrong.
It's great.
But, I wouldn't put... I'm not that much of an edgelord. I wouldn't put Ocarina at the bottom. I own the CDI games. I can't say Ocarina's bad and own those. What? I paid money and I own a CDI. I can't do that.
I'm sorry that you had to put yourself through that. Yep, there you go. There's a kazoo. Obligatory kazoo whenever Colin's on.
I guess so.
And no matter what Nate says, I guess I'm just going to have to title this one like Zelda Informer Episode 24 Urban Champions. So that's all you're going to get. Urban Champions and Kazoos. Like, this is not even going to say anything about what we discussed. Just those two things.
Flintstones. Oh, no, just call it Zelda Informer Episode 24. Granddad! Flintstones?
Okay, so that's all I have for that. But there is like a slight announcement I want to make for next week in case you guys want to stick around. Nate doesn't know this yet. He knows kind of about it yet. Next week, after our favorite games or whatever whatever we're going to talk about in gaming news,
Donald Trump is joining the cell.
No, I want to stay sane. This isn't really a good way to stay sane. Nate and I are going to eat a habanero pepper each and then recite our favorite monologues from a movie or a TV show.
Really?
Oh my gosh.
That's so fucking basic. Bring me on. I'll have a ghost pepper.
If you want to, Colin, you can go for it.
I'll order the...
I don't know where to
get one. I'll order the fucking, towering inferno level hot wings from my local place I like to get buffalo wings from, and I'll read a book. I'll do what I did on the last podcast. Not the old Zelda Informer, where if we didn't have enough content, we just cut to like 20 minutes of me reading a novel. Does anyone miss those? I do. That was fun.
You should petition Nate to just get you reading a novel as part of like a regularly scheduled program.
A lot of fun.
But yeah, that's what my plan is for now. If you, the listener, want us to do anything weird that is legal and doesn't involve getting naked on screen, we will do our best to do it and spice things up each week and make things fantastic and wonderful and great for you guys who don't pay us a dime for this, and I do this for fun.
Yeah, you bet.
Yeah. That's what it is. It's for my pain, for your entertainment. That's what this show will become. I guarantee it. But yeah, I think that's all we have for this week. So where can they find you if they want to follow you guys?
Are you actually going to put a link in the description or my username on screen so I don't have to constantly fucking spell it?
I will. I will put it on screen and I will... It'll be right under your name pretty much the entire time.
Because I remember there was a couple episodes ago. yeah, I imagine if you're looking or listening or watching or however you consume... If you are injecting this podcast directly into your arteries with a caulking gun, my name is going to be printed somewhere pertaining to where you are enjoying this. So look there. If not, Colin Dram, not Kowloon, Colin. All right.
There you go. I'm not putting it up there.
Oh my god, I'm going to fucking slap you.
All right, Ty, what about you?
I'm pretty much Ty Force most places. Twitter, I don't use it much though. You can follow me on Meverse, Ty Force. I need to use that more often actually. But yeah,
Yeah,
add me in Miitomo if you want. Also, I guess you can't really do that. You need to
Facebook friends or Twitter.
That's right. More people need to use Miitomo. No.
As always,
but yeah,
I'm at Full Metal Alfie on Twitter. I want to try something new, and if you guys really want, I don't know why you'd want to. It's just something I thought of when I was editing the last one. If you want to watch me edit this, I'll like Snapchat it.
Oh,
and you can. I'll be all hipster. And wow. Snapchat it. And I think that's at Full Metal Alphamist. I thought it was really clever when I did that. So that might be it. I'm probably wrong. It might be like Proto Alfred or something. I have too many Alfred-based names. Oh well. We'll see. If you can find me. If you want to just no inappropriate pictures, Colin.
But I have a big Mick.
But yeah, that...
My girlfriend got me a big Mickey Mouse for my birthday, so I can...
And the case.
I'll send you my big Mick.
In the cases. All right. On that note, thank you guys for joining us, and we will see you back here hopefully next week. Yeah. Bye.
Thanks for having me.
No problem.